Modern Wahine Hawaii is presented by Inspiration Interiors, home fashion with an attitude.
I'm Brooke Lee, and this is Modern Wahine Hawaii. Aloha everybody and welcome to Modern Wahine Hawaii. I'm your host Brooke Lee, coming to you from Inspiration Interiors with Loretta Ablesier. We've got a lot to talk about.
Yes, we do.
We've got Tonys, we've got Working in Waikiki, we've got Broadway. Let's get started.
Girl talk, go ahead.
So you started performing here in Hawaii. You're a Hawaii girl.
Right.
So talk about the good old days.
The good old days started back in 1979. I started working with Keola and Kapono Beamer, 1979.
Wow. And so you name some of the places that you were performing at. So it was like Andrews?
I started out, yes, working at, with the Beamers at the Ocean Showroom of the Reef Hotel. From there, I went with Andy Bumatai to the Monarch Room of the Royal Hawaiian, and we were there. That's when I was still doing the big show thing. Then I started singing jazz standards and went to Andrew's Restaurant, Ala Moana Hotel.
And then this is what I love about your story, because hard work does pay off. We all know that. But Broadway came calling later in life. You didn't go graduate from, you know, like some theater program, pack up your things and go try to make it on the way.
No.
You were here, you were slogging away, you were doing the work,
right.
Theater, and then
magic happened.
Bali High.
Bali High.
Literally.
I was still singing at night. During the daytime, I sang for Japanese weddings and was taking time off in the evening to be able to do a show at Diamond Head Theater that Lee Catalona and Keola and Kapono Beamer wrote called You Somebody. And Broadway happened, and they decided that they were going to be doing the first revival of South Pacific on Broadway since it had the first time that it opened there in 1949. And they were looking to cast the role as correctly, if I can use that term, as possible. And a friend of mine that had performed on Broadway was talking to the musical director one day and said, you know, have you guys looked in Hawaii? Because that's the South Pacific and I lived there. And I know there are women there that could be able to do this role. And they sent a casting agent out here. And when I auditioned that day, they said, you should hear something maybe in 6 to 8 weeks, because there are large groups of people that have to see this audition tape.
Right.
So you should hear probably 6 or 8 weeks from now. And he called me 2 days later. He had gotten back to New York, and the director saw this tape, and they immediately called me for a call back.
And do you mind asking me how old you were at the time?
Well,
when you went to New York.
When I went to New York, I was 49. And when the show opened at Lincoln Center on April 4th, I believe it was, I had just turned 50 years old.
It's never too late.
It is never too late. And dreams come true.
Never give up.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Oh, chicken skin.
You know, we all set things to happen in our lives in a timeline that we're comfortable for. But it happens when it's supposed to happen. I never made it to like Miss Mililani as opposed to Miss Universe. But so you come into this whole thing thinking, I'm not enough. And through this whole thing, I found out that who I was exactly
what
they were looking for at the time. Whatever you have is exactly what you need to face the world.
And just to put the cherry on top of it, you were nominated for a Tony for that performance at 50.
Can
right?
you believe that?
Right? Okay, so this is about being in the right place at the right time and being prepared.
I could weep. Go ahead.
And then your whole life changed. That's not an understatement. So where can people check you out when you're actually in town?
Actually, I'm going to be performing very soon on November 10th at the Blue Note. It's a Sunday, I believe.
So are we going to be able to get a little bit of a taste of what's happening at the Blue Note?
Yes, absolutely.
And will the fabulous Jim Howard be performing with you
I
at the Blue Note?
I would work without him. Absolutely.
Let's take a look.
Say no, no. sing for you. Oh, you know if you do, you won't regret it. Come and get it. Oh, no one is me. She told me it was naughty, but then, oh, do it again, just do it again, yeah. Oh, oh, no one is near. I may cry, oh,
and again.
I'm here with Kimmy B. You might know her from shows like Hawaii Five-O, but she's been in a lot of other things as well. Tell everybody, how do I pronounce your last name?
It's Balmalero.
Balmalero.
Yeah, it can be intimidating because it's 9 letters.
But... Visayans, Hispanic?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a Filipino derivative.
Yes, yes, exactly.
Yes, yes. Proud Filipino.
Yes, very yes, proud. Yes, 100%.
Yes. Yeah.
So let's establish a couple things. You are a bright kid, which means yes, you're smart, but you are from the castle legacy, right?
Yeah, so I grew up in Kaneohe, so I started doing shows with Ronald Bright at Castle Performing Arts Center when I was 9, actually. I used to do this cool program called Castle Performing Arts program, where they would go to all the elementary schools on the Windward side and, you know, audition-ish kids from 5th grade to 8th grade. And then from all of those schools, which is, you know, a lot of kids, they would get 100 of us and then put us into a musical. So that was like my first taste of doing theater and living on stage, and then I was hooked right after that.
And so being touched by the Bright legacy, it really catapulted you into a next world, because you were really young when you left Hawaii. You were 16?
I was barely. I was 17. I was actually still in high school when I auditioned for Miss Saigon, which was a Broadway musical at the time. So yeah, I was in high school. I didn't think anything of it. It was kind of a thing that bright kids just did, you know? You just auditioned for a Broadway show, right. I guess. You know, Mr. Bright's program kind of like showed me that being who you are can really take you to the next level. I mean, that confidence was everything for that audition.
Right. So. And so then that set you on a whirlwind tour, because you were gone.
Mm-hmm.
And then you settled after the Broadway experience in, where did you go after that?
Oh, well, you know, I did the national tour, so we were all going all over the country in Canada for about 2.5 years with Miss Saigon. I did not want to go to New York or LA just yet. I thinking back on that experience, I'm not sure why I decided that. I'm thankful that I did, but I just knew, I was like, I need a little bit more training. So I decided to stay in San Francisco to kind of separate myself from those two cities and industries for a little bit to learn more acting, right, to learn more musical theater stuff. And then I went to New York, a year, 6 months after Saigon closed.
Wow.
Yeah, and then from there, just really hustling. Right. I think people assume that, oh, once you've done a big job, you can do
retire.
All the big jobs. Yeah, but that's not how it happens, you know? And I had so many, I guess what we would call here in Hawaii, like sisters and brothers and aunties and uncles that I met on the tour that really guided me to taking my career further. And on my own again, I booked the original Broadway cast of Mamma Mia.
Right, that's a big deal.
Yeah.
That's a big deal. And that's a multi-cast, that's a multi-cast of different races. Really.
Yeah, it was cool. I remember the first day I walked in because, you know, back then it was, 2000, I think, is when we started rehearsals for Mamma Mia. And there was another Asian female in the cast. And, you know, her name was Yuka Takara, and she'd already done, like, a bunch of stuff. But we both saw each other at auditions, or not auditions, at the first day of rehearsal, and we were like,
you're like me.
Yeah, we were like, is one of us not supposed to be there? But yeah, Mamma Mia has always been really, really cool about that. They want a cast that was very colorful and diverse. That was neat.
After all of that, let's talk about the TV stuff you've done for a while. You started the television show for kids.
Yeah.
High Five.
Mm-hmm.
That was a good experience for you. I'm assuming that got you into a lot of homes.
Oh yeah,
of kids.
Yeah, High Five was really special in that it was like Sesame Street in a way, but also kind of like being a pop star to preschoolers. So of course I love Sesame Street, and I like that their vision was to never talk down to the kids. You know, you were kind of there with them. You were one of them, one of their mentors. While doing High Five, it was kind of everything that I love doing wrapped into one gig. You know, it was a TV show, which I'd never done before. And one of the biggest notes that I always get is just like, tone it down just a little bit.
Because you're from theater.
I'm from theater. I'm like, hello, welcome, kids.
Yes.
Like, you're right here. But then we also got to sing and dance a lot. Dance is my first love. I started with 24/7 Dance Force. So, and then we also got to record albums and we got to do live shows.
Right. You decided to give back because, I mean, being on Hawaii 5-0 is a big deal. 4 years, congratulations.
Thank you.
But you could have just stopped by doing that, but you didn't. You wanted to get back into the community that gave you so much.
Yeah.
And you wanted to talk about, you know, doing everything that you did in the improv world. So you started this whole improv movement.
Yep. I started Improv Hawaii or Improv HI. It just started off as an online website, actually, as like a hub to find all improv comedy shows. And that quickly turned into you know, showcases and into free classes, free shows. And then now, you know, oh my gosh, 8 years later, we've now expanded to offering five classes a week. We have an entire curriculum that takes you from the very beginning all the way to advanced study.
Right.
We offer rap workshops, we offer musical workshops, we do free Saturday shows right here in Kaka'ako at Revolusan. We have everyday people that take our classes, you know, people that work at the bank, people that are stay-at-home parents, people that are, you know, that I did theater when I was in kindergarten, but I always had that spark.
Right.
It really allows them to fulfill that desire and need in a very safe and non-judgmental and free space, you know, because improv, you're making things up.
Right.
So it's been really cool to kind of see that progression with Improv HI, not just as the company grows, but as we touch more people and you know, expand their thoughts on what theater is and how the arts can help them.
Right. Well, thanks so much for everything that you've done. I mean, you could have stayed abroad, you could have done all of that. You decided to come home and give back to the community. That's because you're raised right.
I love
you're
Hawaii.
A bright kid.
I am a bright kid.
You're a bright kid. He'll be so proud of you.
Aww.
Well, thank you again.
Thanks.
For being on our
Thanks
show.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, you're going to have to come back. We'll do a little bit of improv. That'll be fun.
Ooh, yeah. I do it all the time.
So don't go anywhere. When we come back, we'll be with Inspiration Interiors. I'm here with Julia at Inspiration Interiors. Hi, Julia.
Hi, Brooke.
It's the fa-la-la-la season, isn't it? We're talking about Maker's Market?
The Maker's Market,
Let's talk about the Maker's Market.
So this is our third official Maker's Market here at Inspiration, and we're really, really excited. The last two were a huge success. And so basically, it'll be November 23rd from 11 to 3, and we bring in a bunch of different local vendors. So we'll have about 15 local vendors, anything from clothing to jewelry, ceramics to journals to even like a little dog store stand.
Nice.
We'll have, for like organic treats. And then, so those will all be selling, and we actually place them throughout the showroom, so it's kind of an experience to like walk through the store and get to the different vendors at the same time.
And do a little holiday shopping and support local businesses.
Yes.
Nice, nice. And then are there any like demonstrations or anything going on?
Yes, so we also have a couple workshops. Specifically, we have one for olive oil. So we actually have somebody coming in who makes their own olive oil, and they'll be doing demos on, I don't know much about olive oil, so I think demos on how to make it and pretty much what to pair it with and all that good stuff. And then we'll also have a tea demonstration.
Oh, neat.
Yes.
So they'll
be
selling teas as well, you think? Or?
Yes, I believe so. Everything will be sold as well.
Nice.
Yes.
Great. And so this is your third one? So you usually have them when in the summer?
So we had one last winter, and then we had one this summer, and then this will be our fall one, per se. Yeah, so, but we wanted to put it right before Christmas so that people could get their gifts.
And then if you're out there and you are a maker of some sort, like how would people know if they wanted to be like, hey, that's like something I would want to do? How would they get in touch with you about that?
So I would definitely say the easiest way is just to DM us on Instagram, honestly, or you can email Inspiration, the media Inspiration, which you can find online. But yeah, pretty much just contacting us through social media would be the easiest way.
And how do you guys find some of your makers?
A lot of people are word of mouth, gotten friends of friends, and then the first people, we've kind of like, the people who did our first Makers Market, they're kind of going along with us, and then they know other people, and so we're kind of just like word of mouth, just getting it out there.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for supporting local businesses.
Yeah, of course.
So important,
we're so excited.
Especially with the holiday season, everyone's so busy. So they can come here, they can do some yoga, I heard. Is a yoga a thing?
Yes, so we also, we have a 10 o'clock yoga, and we'll actually have that in the cupola. So from 10 to 11, there'll be yoga, which is free. Mm-hmm. You just come in with your mat and get your sweat on.
Right.
And then at 11, you can go out and you can start shopping, and all the vendors will be set up.
Because you do have to limber up before you shop.
Exactly.
So remind us again, what are the dates?
It'll be November 23rd from 11 to 3 p.m.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for supporting local businesses, getting your shopping on, and a little bit of yoga. It'll be a lot of fun. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm here at Adventist Health Castle with Kristen Polenz, who's the imaging director here. Hi, Kristen.
Hey.
Let's talk a little bit about your background. So you are from Arizona originally?
So I grew up in a small town, Arizona, town of about 7,000 people, like east of Phoenix, kind of up in the mountains where it actually does get cold and snow a little bit. Started out my imaging career there as an X-ray CT tech, and then ended up as manager and kind of went from there.
So I hear we kind of have some similarities because you were in the rodeo pageant profession for a little bit?
A little bit different, kind of beauty pageant, but still, it's important.
It's in the lane. It's still in the lane.
Still in the lane, but we got the horses.
So you've been in Hawaii how long?
I've been here about 3 years. Mm-hmm. I was actually living in Colorado and got out of the hot tub one night and decided I was done being cold. So started looking around, found Castle, and just really felt this connection with the mission and loved the area and said, you know what, I'm gonna take the risk on this.
Awesome. Well, it is important, the work you do, because, you know, breast cancer, especially here in Hawaii, I mean, it is prevalent everywhere, but so I wanted to talk a little bit about some tips you might have to educate women and men about the experience of the whole having to do mammography.
Yes. So the biggest thing we're telling everyone, so we know mammos save lives.
Yes.
We know if you catch it early, there's a 98% cure rate.
Right.
So you want to catch it before you can feel it. We also are telling everyone, you know what? So you got yours. Did you ask your friends? And we're finding, you know, that kind of interaction. Ask your friends, ask your family. You know, it is annually after age 40.
Ah, okay.
So every year you should be getting your mammo.
Right.
So one of the big advances in mammography has been going from a flat 2D, which would just superimpose everything, to a 3D tomosynthesis, which takes an entire stack of images. So the doctor can see at every level without things superimposing as much. And that's made a big difference, especially for younger women or women with denser breasts. To hopefully rule things out and make them not have to come back for additional images.
Right, which can be stressful.
Which can be stressful.
Right.
And you know, we like to remind people it's very common. Mm-hmm. So if you do get a call back, don't panic.
Right.
You know, come in, let us take another look. Lots of Most of the time, it's going to be nothing, but just something we might want to follow up on.
Let's talk about men for a second, because men get breast cancer.
Men do get breast cancer.
As long as you have a breast,
yes.
Cancer is a thing.
Yep.
How does that work for, do men have to get?
So men don't get the annual screenings.
They don't, do they?
No, they get away with it.
Uh-huh.
But if a man feels something different, mm-hmm. or if he has any kind of discharge or changes, mm-hmm. he definitely wants to go to his doctor. The statistic is actually about 1 in 100 men will develop some kind of breast cancer. So, you know, don't ignore it. Don't put it aside. Don't say, oh, I'm a man, that'll never happen.
Right.
Make sure you do go tell your doctor.
Right. Because women are sort of, not trained, but we're educated to do self exams from a young age, just to mm-hmm. be aware.
And so for ladies too, right. you know, if you see a change in your man,
right.
make sure you say
right.
something and make him go get it checked
see?
Out too.
It's always on us.
It is. It is. But a good portion of cancers are found by partners.
Right. And it's all about early detection.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Well, thanks again, Kristen.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you so much for coming and visiting us. And, you know, we do have night and weekend, so no excuses.
Exactly. Well, thanks so much for watching today. I want to thank Loretta Ablis-Sayer. I was so moved to have her come here to Inspiration Interior and sing for us. Looking so forward to her concert coming up. Thank you to Kimmy B. We love her on her shows, but we also love her for all of the stuff she's doing for improv here in Hawaii. If you want to get into the improv business, check out Kimmy B. Thank you so much to Adventist Health Castle for all the work they're doing with mammogram screenings. They're important, and we all need to get them done. Also, I want to thank Inspiration Interiors. Julia is always hooking me up. I'm looking forward to the Maker's Market. And also, if you're not doing anything, you can come join me on November 10th at the Blue Note, because I will be there in front watching Loretta do what she does best. It's November 10th at 7 p.m. at the Blue Note. Don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Instagram. Let us know what you'd like us to check out. We're always watching our feeds. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next week.
Modern Wahine Hawaii was filmed on location at Inspiration Interiors, Hawaii's best value in home furnishings.